Hello, I'm Kirsty Young, and this is a download from the Desert Island Discs archive. This edition may be slightly different from what was actually broadcast, but it is the only version we have. It comes from the British Library's radio collection. The recording didn't contain the guests' 8 music choices, so we rebuilt the original show by using discs from the BBC Gramophone Library. For rights reasons, we've had to shorten the music. Full details can be found on the Castaways page on the Desert Island Discs website. The programme was originally broadcast in 1981, and the presenter was Roy Plumley.
On our desert island this week is the soprano Montserrat Caballe. Now, you have just 8 records to take with you. How did you set about choosing? Are you choosing nostalgically, or are they the voices of friends, or was there any kind of rule that you set yourself?
I choosing some for personal memories.
Yes.
Some because of the composers. And most of them because it's music.
Right. Well, what's the first one?
To going to the island, the first one has to be the second act entrance of Brunhilde of the Valkyrie, and of course by Birgit Nilsson.
Why do you choose this?
Because Birgit, when I heard his voice, the way she sings this entrance, it is something immense.
Birgit Nilsson, her entrance from Act 2 of Die Walküre. Now, Madame Caballé, you're a Catalan, yes?
Yes. I was born in Catalonia, and my country is Spain.
Was there a lot of music in your home?
Yes, indeed. Because my parents love music, they have lots of recordings. We were a very simple family, human family, and very hard times.
Yes. Did you have
the war and after the war? So they try very constantly to buy and the recordings. They love it, and I was used from my very first moment, I think, in life, to listen to music, no matter which kind. They love it, of course, classical music, opera, zarzuelas, concerts. I thought many times I was sleeping, listening to some kind of music when I was a very, very child.
When you were a child, the Civil War was waging. That
yes.
Gave you a very hard time.
Really, I was born April 33, 12th of April 33, and the war begins in Spain in 36. So I was 3 years old. Mm. My memories of the war are not very clear in my mind. But things I remember, for example, is my father in the hospital, which I went with my mother to visit him because he was injured, you say?
In the bombing?
No, in the front.
He was fighting?
Yes, of course, he was a soldier. And he was hurt, I mean, badly hurt.
Yes.
And we went to the hospital, and that I remember. I remember two bombing in Barcelona, and my father carrying me in his arm, going steps down, very quick, and I remember sort of subterranean.
Yes.
Hundreds of people went there.
Cellars.
I assume so, yes. And that I remember too.
Was your home hit? Was your home?
Yes, destroyed, yes.
Destroyed?
Yes, yes.
So the record collection of your father was damaged, was it?
Yes, it was damaged very much indeed. Mm-hmm. And he began after the war to save whatever he could save and to recollect it again.
Yes.
Whatever we could, he could, I mean, and my mother too. And the war finished, I was 6 years old. And I remember when my brother was born, I was 9 years old, my only brother. And at the time, it was a large collection, 3 years after the war, because I remember listening many times to Miguel Fleta, which mm-hmm. my father was a great admirer, and Björling. My father loved Björling. It was really, I assume, the beginning of Björling at the time. And Lázaro. And Caruso, of course. All my father loved tenor voices, you see.
Did he sing himself?
No.
When did he first take you to the opera house?
Not even 8. It was the first season they reopened the opera house in Barcelona after the war. And it was with Madame Butterfly, Mercedes Capsir, an old singer of ours, sang Butterfly. And to me it was great impression, because I ever see an opera before. I only listening to the music.
Yes. You were what, 6 then?
No, I was, I think, 7 and a half, like that.
When did you start music lessons yourself?
Well, I began at the Conservatorio in Barcelona with 8, only music, solfeggio.
Yes.
And with 12, then I put on piano too, mm-hmm. clavier.
Yes.
And then they begin to say, have a voice, the teachers in the school, in the conservatorium in Barcelona. So with 14, then I begin to study voice with a Hungarian teacher, Eugenia Kemeny.
A Hungarian teacher?
Hungarian teacher. She was in Bayreuth many years, and she was a singer in the Berlin Opera. And the lady, she was an old lady at the time she dies, a few years ago, she listened to my voice and she says, it's a wonderful voice, has a future. But first we have to make gymnastic. And for 8 months, really, I was doing only what she calls gimnasia respiratoria.
Breathing gymnastics.
Yes. She was, when she was young in his country, gold medal of Olympics
running?
Says.
Yes.
She was, I think, 18 or 19 years old at the time. So for her, that was the most important thing, to have this kind of control of breath, which is the fundament for singing later. Mm-hmm. I was desperate, 8 months gymnastic. I wanted to sing, but I thank very much my teacher. He teach me this way too, please.
You were also studying nursing at that time,
yes,
were you not?
A little later. I was finishing with 14, and in 16 I was... how do you know that?
I have my sources.
yes.
This was a second string, as we say. This was
yes, my father wanted absolutely that I have something real in life, not only dreams.
He must be very proud when he plays your records.
Ah, no, Papa never plays my records.
Does he not?
No, because Papa says...
What does Papa say?
Sorry. Well, Papa says that... excuse me, huh? That's what Papa says. he says that really my voice, for him, mm-hmm. please don't forget it's my father,
yes.
My voice is a special sound. And this special sound has been never put it in a record.
He doesn't think the records do you justice.
Not my sound.
No.
That's what he says.
Right. Now, I know you won a gold medal, which is Spain's highest award to a student singer. What was your very first engagement on the operatic stage? What was the first role you sang?
As a student, I was singing La Selva Padrona from
Pergolesi,
Il Telefono from Menotti. I sang Maria Egiziaca from Respighi and the Ninth Symphony, all in Spain when I was finishing, almost finishing. And then my first engagement really was in Basel, in Switzerland. And I sang small parts, very small parts, like Amnina in Traviata, like First Lady in Zauberflöte. And then I sang a part which I find wonderful in the Feurige Engel von Prokofiev. And I was so happy because I really wondering this line. It was lovely. So the first ensemble rehearsal when I came, that was a sextet. And I was so depressed because I always thought when I was a student, they only give me my music at the opera house. So I thought that was a solo, but it was not. Oh, it was a sextet. Yeah. Well, anyway, that was my first roles.
You're right.
Yes.
Let's break off for another record. What's the second one you've chosen?
La Juive, Rachel, Count du Seigneur, because of Richard Tucker.
La Juive by Alevi.
Yes.
And why do you like Richard Tucker so much? Did you work with him ever?
Yes, at the beginning in my career in America, in the United States, I sang with him several times. It was something like a human being trying to do his job the best he could, trying to help other people to growing up in the career. He was a person that loves music over everything. Mm-hmm. And the respect he has for all the rest of his colleagues, it is something as an example. And because as example, is the only tenor I take with me in the island.
Richard Tucker singing an aria from Alevi's La Juive. Now, you started off in Bâle. You were a sort of unpaid understudy for a start, weren't you?
Yeah, that's true. Mm-hmm. But what I learned at the time was incredible. I will have not money enough to pay it today, what I have learned in that time.
You learned the repertoire.
Not only that. Mm. I learned many things in that time, really.
How long were you in Bâle?
3 years.
So having learned so much of the German repertoire, you were then suited to go on to Bremen. That was your next place of work.
Yes, I was in Bremen 3 years too.
Now that was hard work. I read that in 1 week there you sang in 5 different operas.
It's true.
They kept you busy.
It is because the other soprano was ill, you know? Mm. At the time the soprano was ill too. So they had to put me in. And so I sang what I was supposed to do, 2 or 3 of my parts and 2 or 3 of the other soprano parts. So that kept me in voice for that week.
When did you first sing in your own hometown in Barcelona?
7th of January, 1962.
A date you remember. It must have been a great thrill to go back and sing.
Yes, it took me 6 years to... You know, the conservatorium in Barcelona is on the top of the opera house.
Yes.
So it took me to travel over all Europe and 6 years to go from the conservatorium to the stage of
to
my
come
opera
downstairs.
House. Yes. But when the special night was with Arabella from Richard Strauss, mm-hmm. and to me it was one of my loveliest memories, really, it is. Yes.
Well, you went on making an impact here and there. Now, you made a big impact in Mexico. That was important,
yes,
wasn't
it? Yes, it was in 63 first with concerts and 64 with opera.
That
yes.
was in Manon.
Yes, that was with Giuseppe Di Stefano.
Was it that success in Mexico that led to your first New York appearance?
Oh, no, not at all. I mean, the success in Mexico with Manon and Ballo in Mascara, which I sang for the first time in my career, and it was with Giuseppe Di Stefano too, brought me 2 contracts. Could you imagine? One, $2 to do Zeffirelli Straviata, and second, to Philadelphia to do Andrea Chenier with Franco Corelli. So, this contract was made in the fall of 64 because this performance is supposed to take place following season. Mm-hmm. Only in April 65 when the event of Carnegie Hall of Lucrezia Borgia, because Madame Marilyn Horn was expecting Patricia, she was pregnant. And she thought, Marilyn, that she could do it because, you know, I was pregnant twice too. So I had the children. And you think, till when I can go on? I assume for Marilyn was the same question for herself. And you go on, till you realize, well, no, I cannot go on. I have planned that, but I have to stop perhaps 1 month earlier or so. I assume it was the same for Marilyn. And then they offer me this opportunity to do this role in New York. And there was a problem because, you see, Dallas have signed me a contract to say his first appearance in the United States for Traviata. Of course, on a stage was in the contract because of this on a stage. I could do the concert at Carnegie Hall.
The concert before. That's not on the stage, of course.
No, this is
on
a platform.
And you had a great success. They love particularly that marvelous pianissimo of yours.
That's what they say, yes.
Now, you sang Lucrezia in New York. This happened a long time ago, so we can now tell the story. Your next engagement was at Glyndebourne, but because you had had to learn Lucrezia, you didn't know your Glyndebourne part, did you, when you arrived?
Well, I knew it only not right. That's true. I have never denied it. And I'm not going to begin yet to say excuses.
What were you going to sing? What was the part?
Rosenkavalier.
Ah, yes.
It was the first time.
Yes.
And I have learned the part in February, end of February, beginning of March, just beginning to study the part because it was plenty of time. It was 2 months before I was supposed to be in Glyndebourne, so I take it easy, like always. So when I arrive in Glyndebourne, of course, I have not had the time to continue Rosenkavalier because I was doing Lucrezia Borgia. First thing I thought is to speak with the conductor.
Who was it?
The conductor was our lovely, I really don't want to say the name, please.
Right, we won't mention Mr. Pritchard.
No, yes. No, because he was so sweet, yes. And I don't want it. You know, he said, now that you say it, I say what he tells me.
All right. Go on.
You know, and I tell you why I don't want it. Say it, because when I arrive, I speak with him. I tell him, I don't know the part. I know a little, but not much. He says, okay, come and we have a rehearsal. Let me see, how do you know the part? So that was the 21st, 22nd, 23rd, something like that. So very short of time, as you can see. And we rehearse. And after the monologue, he stops. And he says, well, do you think you can go on after the fifth performance? And I says, no. As I do all, or I don't do none. And he was looking at me like he looks of something very strange, I'm sure. And he says, do you know, very nice, really very nice, you will see. Do you know how much time every soprano has approached this role, need to prepare this role like has to be? I says, yes, I know that. And do you think you can do it in 15 days? I says, yes, I know I can. And he was shocked. I says, well, I am not only sure, I am sure you're not. I says, yes, you I understand you sang this way. He says, well, we have to look for another soprano that you understand. I says, you look, but you don't engage a soprano, and give me 5 days. He says, 5 days? He says, 5 days, a piano and a pianist. He says, I can do it. I says, no, I do it in my way, the way I'm learning. And then you decided if you make the engagement for the other soprano or you take me. He was laughing, but he was very sweet. And he says, all right, Montserrat, I only do this because you are very young and because somehow in your eyes, it's really what he tells me, you know. It says me that's going to happen. I don't know how, but your eyes say so. So sometimes in life, they succeed wonders. Could be this time happens. I don't know. I love your voice. I love the way you do. Let's see how practical you are. So I close myself in the house where we have rented. And I was working morning, afternoon, night. And I was sleeping with Elizabeth Schwarzkopf recording of Rosen Cavalier. Everything. I put my watch at 6 o'clock in the morning. And so after 5 days, I went to do this rehearsal. And I arrived without the score. And he was looking at me and he says, do you have the score? I says, yes, I forgot home. And he says, do you want one? I says, no, better I take it with me tomorrow. So I go through all part, full par cœur.
By heart.
Memory.
Yes.
I only make five
mistakes.
When we finish it, he says, maestro says, please thank you everybody, because it was an ensemble rehearsal. And he says, Miss Cavalier, will you remain, please? So I remain. And I thought, now come the moment. I was trembling, but I don't knew what he's going to say. And he says, I am deeply, deeply sorry. And in the moment he says that, I was sitting down because I thought, oh, I lost my contract. Really? But he makes a big pause. And then he says, because we have to say the other soprano, we don't need her. And I think this is one of the most beautiful stories I can really, because maestro was really sweet, understanding, and he's still today telling me, I don't believe it, what that happens. I am sure you have learned it before, only you don't tell me.
You can learn very quickly when you have to.
Never like this time. I have never done it again. It was the only time.
Right. Let's have your third record. What's that? What's number three?
This is Fritz Wunderlich in Zauberflöte. This building is bezauberschön.
The picture aria?
Yes.
Why do you choose it?
Because when I was in Bremen, my 4 year of career, my first year season in Bremen, they called me to do Zauberflöte in the festival in Lausanne. And they explained to me that Wunderlich was the tenor. I could believe it, but it was. So I went there. And at the moment of the pre-generale, before the dress rehearsal, he was looking for this business, you know, the little thing they have in the hand.
The little picture.
The little picture. And they don't find it, they don't find it. And I have it at the time to have in here.
A little miniature?
Yes.
Round your neck?
Yes. Mm-hmm. And it was done for a big miniaturist in Barcelona through the family that have paid me the studio.
Yes.
Sponsor, you say? Sponsor. And they know this person and they make a miniature of myself.
Mm-hmm.
So I think it was when I was 19. It was a wonderful miniature. I don't have it anymore. And so, because it was almost the same shape, the one he held it, I told him, Herrn Wunderlich, wollen Sie das? In the moment, do you want this for the moment? And he saw it, says, yes, thank you. And he sang the Olaria with that. He asked me then for the Generale, and he asked me for the premiere, and I was very surprised because they have found it already. And I told him, Herr Wunderlich, why do you ask me that when you have the piece of the theater? And she says, because this building is really wunderschön, and they make me an inspiration.
Yes.
You mind I keep it for my future summer flutes? I give it to him. I'm sorry, I give it to him. And he has always said it before
He always sang this aria to your miniature.
After that time, yes.
Oh, that's a nice compliment.
It was, really.
Let's listen to him. Fritz Wunderlich singing the picture aria from The Magic Flute. When did you first sing at Covent Garden?
My first role, it was in Traviata. And I think, when my memory don't make me tricks, it was about 1971, I think, something like 71,
yes.
72.
And 70. Now, of course, you're a regular visitor, we're glad to say.
Well, yes, almost.
And you toured with the Covent Garden Company in the Far East, didn't you?
Yes, it was a wonderful experience, marvelous.
You
them.
Sing a very wide variety of roles, including modern composers like Berg and Hindemith, Stravinsky.
Yeah. Do you know that? Because I have not sung that for many years either.
I know, but you used to. How many roles do you have in your repertoire?
102.
102? That is a lot, isn't it?
Yeah.
How many operas have you recorded?
33 operas, complete.
And it's obvious that you have a very special affection for early Verdi.
Well, I love it very much indeed, yes.
In Spain, have you ever sung in those very special Spanish operettas, the zarzuelas?
Yes, not in the zarzuelas really, because it's not companies. And when they put a company together, it is... for them to
it's
work.
It's very specialized, isn't it?
Yes, it is. I have sung in concerts some arias,
yes.
Some duets. I have do some recordings of arias, zarzuela, and duets. And I have recorded zarzuelas too, complete. I think it's 3 or 4, not very much indeed. But it's a music that we like very much. And when we have singers abroad, I mean in other countries like England, like New York, etc., and lately in Vienna, they love it. They really do. So...
Let's move on to your next record. What shall we have?
We have Maria.
Maria Callas.
Yes. Because, like always, I want to have Maria with me, no matter where I am.
Did you know her well?
Yes. Yes, indeed. And from Maria, I would like to listen in this island the little recitativo before the Non crede mirarte, which is l'anello, l'anello, ho perduto. And she says always that in that small recitativo, he explained his own life in these few words. And the people that we know her well, we know it's true. Only in this particular part. So, because she represents for me the greatest musician and the greatest singer all times.
Maria Callas in a recitative from Bellini's La Somnambula. How far ahead do you book engagements?
Well, my last engagement is for the season 85-86.
As far ahead as that?
Yeah, I don't have many for that season, but I have already three.
Yeah, so you're all...
They ask me to sign, I sign. What something...
Oh, not always, I'm sure.
Not always, but what something really I like...
How important in your career do you consider recitals?
Very important.
And you like them to be informal? You like to chat to the audience? You don't like them to be daunting
not
occasions?
Not really, but you see after a recital, when you really go to the encores, you don't need to play anymore diva, what they call diva.
Yes.
And I think for the audience, it's nice too, because they know you have done... whatever, better or not better, your reciter, your Liederabend, like has to be. Mm. And after, enjoy very much with the audience together. For the, that says what is perhaps a joy for them and a joy for ourselves. Because a joy, you have done a good performance, you have done your job well, the audience has enjoyed it. So it's the moment... the says of celebration. The encores are the cup of
yes,
champagne for
yes,
me.
Exactly. Are you a nervous performer?
Yes, very, very much.
Do you have superstitions?
I don't think so.
Certain clothes or certain objects you like to have?
No. I mean, I am so big. I mean, so fatty. that perhaps I like not to look more as I am. And sometimes I ask if they try to make at least like I am. I don't know if that is a superstition. Well, no, I don't think I have superstitions. Mm. At least I don't remember in that moment.
Right. Record number 5. We had Bellini. Where do we go now?
We have the Winterstürme from Walküre with Melchior.
Melchior?
Mm.
Why do you choose him?
Because my father loved it, because I love it, because I think that it was a real Wagner tenor.
Winterstürme wiegen dem von dem Mond, im milden Lichte leuchtet der Lenz, auf linden Lüften leicht und lieblich, wunderweben der sich wiegt. Durch Wald und Auen weht sein Atem, weit geöffnet lacht sein Ohr. O sel'ger Vöglein, sanges, süßer tönt, tollte Düfte auf der Maus, seinem warmen Blut entblühen wonnige Blumen, Keim und Spross entspringt seiner Kraft.
Melchior in the first act of Wagner's The Valkyrie. Where is your home?
In Barcelona, in Spain.
How far out of the town?
We have an apartment in the city because of the school of the children are in the city.
You have two children, is that right?
Yes, a boy of 14 and a girl of 9. Mm. I marry very old. And
nonsense.
And, well, and we have a farm, which you have the what we call the real house, the real home.
Do you raise stock or crops?
It is a forest farm, you say. So this is where the trees every year, they signal the protection of the mountains.
Yes.
How many trees every year you can
cut
bring down for the necessary of the wood.
Yes, forestry.
Yeah. But in the same time, in all these years, we have some cows.
Mm.
And we have two different races.
Two different kinds of
yes,
of
yes,
stock.
Two different kinds. One is Charolais from Strasbourg in France, and the other are Limousin, which is the other part, close to the Normandy up.
Mm-hmm.
And then we have what we call our own Aranesas. And he has these three kinds which he has developed, and we have many, many little children of them. And it's wonderful.
I'm told that you love working on the farm. You like driving tractors.
Well, I do. Well, you know. I mean, I don't do it well, but sometimes I have done it, yes.
Yes.
It's difficult and it's dangerous.
Now, you're married to the tenor, Barnabé Marty.
Yes.
Can you often sing together?
Well, at the beginning when we know each other, it was on a stage, it was with Madame Butterfly.
Mm.
And at the beginning we could not sing together. Then after 1 year, we were married to the 1.5, he left his agent and we went together in the same agency. And then it was for us possible not really to sing very much together, but at least to be in America together, in Europe together. And in 1972, my husband has an accident when we were singing in Paris, the Norma. And he has a stomach hemorrhage. Yeah.
Yes.
And it was very bad. He has an operation. And after he sang Les and Les, and in 74, I think it was the year, he stopped singing because of his health. Now it's
yes.
Wonderful. And in the farm, he's very healthy. And every time he can and his work permitted, he's coming and... Otherwise, I have 22 nieces.
22 nieces?
Yes, and everyone chooses his free time to make me company in my trips, which is
yes.
Wonderful.
How much time do you get a term with your husband and children at the farm?
At the farm, every year I am there 1 month in summertime. And then, of course, when the children have the holidays in pack,
yes.
We are almost there all the time.
And I know that even between performances, you fly off just to spend a day.
You know very much. I am not supposed to tell you that.
No, you're not.
Because I am supposed to be in the city.
Yes.
Only my luggage is in the hotel. They
right.
remain in the hotel.
Yes.
So no matter, I can be in the Sussex, no? Taking good air. Instead
nobody
that,
knows.
I'm going to the farm.
Nobody knows that technically you're breaking your contract. Let's get on to record number 6. What shall we have now?
We have the 4 last songs with Elisabeth Schwarzkopf
yes.
from Strauss. Strauss is one of my beloved composers, and nobody ever sang a Strauss like Elisabeth Schwarzkopf. And I choose the last song, Im Abendrot, because when you are in a desert island again and you have to take 8 records, I think you have to think in the memories, in the good things, in the nice things, in the musical things. And when the time pass, one day you go. So it's good to have a music to prepare yourself. So I think this is a music of that kind, with his magical voice.
Thank you.
Elizabeth Schwarzkopf singing in Abendrot the last of Richard Strauss's four last songs, and alas, only a part of it. Let's go straight on now to your seventh record. What next?
It is the Ballada Opus 23 from Chopin, played by Benedetto Michelangeli. He's like magic. And in this Ballada 23, Chopin is magic too. So two magicians together, I think for a desert island is something superb.
Of Chopin's Ballade No. 1 in G minor, Opus 23. Could you look after yourself on a desert island? There you are. It's quite a nice island. The climate is good, and there's fresh water, and there are trees.
Of course I could. Why not? Imagine the calm.
Yes, and you're very good on the farm, so obviously you're good with your hands. You could build a shelter, somewhere to live, a hut?
Yes, of course I could.
What could you find to eat?
Well, first, raíces, because you never go any poison of raíces. I don't know if you know that, but
raíces
are... Raíces are roots.
Roots.
And later on, look for fruits, if there is any, in the island.
Yes. What about fish? Can you fish? Have you ever done any fishing?
You see, a fish is an animal.
Yes.
And this is another point which we have not touched, but I feel myself as an animal, too. As an animal that... has the right to think. I don't think he has the right to eat another animal, excuse me.
No, you don't eat meat.
I don't.
Will you try to escape?
From the island?
Yes.
Why?
Well, I thought you might like to get home if you build a craft or you could sail home on a raft.
Listen, one needs an island where you're going alone to be the rest of your life. You don't try to escape. You accept it. Mm. One is an island that you're going and can escape. You don't take 8 records.
Right. So you're going to settle there. And what's your last record? What's the 8th record you've got with you?
This is the record that's Kathleen Ferrier.
Mendelssohn's Elijah.
Because I think, really, that it's very... human pray, this Mendelssohn song.
Prayer.
Prayer, yes. And somehow, somewhere, has to be a Lord. And because has to be a Lord, it's good to pray to a Lord, like a human being. And Mendelssohn, in this song, has produced a song, which is a pray, that prays as a human being to a Lord. I think in the moment you die, or in the moment you feel you're going to die, you have to pray to a Lord. That is why I chose this Mendelssohn.
Thank you.
Kathleen Ferrier singing O Rest in the Lord from Mendelssohn's Elijah. Now, if you could choose only one record instead of eight, which would it be?
Either I have all, or either I have only the memories of all. I don't choose one.
Right. They're all equally precious.
To me, yes.
Right. Now, you may take one luxury with you.
A box to put the records in and something to clean it so that they keep as long as I'm going to live there.
What a good idea. Won't let the sun get at them. And one book. Now, you already have the Bible and the works of Shakespeare.
Well, Dan, we don't need it because I wanted to choose the Bible and he's already there. And with the Bible, you know, you never feel alone because you agree or you don't agree with them, what is written there. And a thousand times you read the Bible, a thousand times you discover something new. I think it's really, with all the respects to all the other books in the world, it's the only book, really, that you never know what is in it.
So that will suffice.
Mm-hmm.
And thank you, Montserrat Caballe, for letting us hear your Desert Island Discs.
Thank you very much for inviting me to this... how do you say it in English?
Desert Island?
To this...
Program.
Oh, program. Listen, my English goes worse and worse.
It's getting better and better. And thank you very much
thank
for coming.
You. Thank
Goodbye,
you.
Everyone.
Bye.
You've been listening to a download from the Desert Island Discs archive. For more downloads, please visit the Radio 4 website.